Baik, selamat pagi. Good morning, class. Okay, this is the last week of this teaching week. So, and also we will come to the last few slides that we are going to look at on method of least work. Specifically, we will look at how you actually solve statically indeterminate structures. And it covers truss, beams, and frames on how we solve this using method of least work. Now, before that, just try to recap what we have briefly looked at on method of least work. Method of least work is used to solve statically indeterminate structures. And one of the important characteristics of statically indeterminate structures that makes it not able to solve by using equilibrium equation is redundancy. Redundancy comes with extra restraint in the form of support, like this example here, or in the form of extra members. So this redundancy is a specific characteristics of statically determinate indeterminate structures compared to statically determinate ones. So redundancy, having extra supports or extra members. Okay. And the extra support is the redundant one. The extra restraint here, roller, is redundant. The extra member, either one of these, is extra. Extra means you don't need them actually for the structures to be able to take the load in a stable way. And whatever extra reaction forces here, extra member forces here, they are called the extra supports, and you have extra reactions or extra members or extra member forces. So those are the redundant forces. In method of least work, we solve for the redundant first, then we go for the other forces using equilibrium equations. So that's why it's important for you to be able to choose to identify which redundant and what causes the redundancy. So we choose the redundant and the corresponding redundant force to be solved first. Then after that, only you use the rest, you solve for the rest of the unknown forces. For example, solve for this, then solve for these three using equilibrium equation. Solve for this, then solve for the rest using equilibrium equations. Then you solve the problem completely. Okay, so method of least work, redundant force is determined first. You calculate redundant force first using compatibility equations. Then other unknown forces. Okay, you still need equilibrium equations because equilibrium equations are still needed to find other forces. And method of least work is one type of force method of analysis. And the other method is method of consistent deformations. If you look through other books, it covers this, but we do not cover it here. This method of least work is the one that we cover, and the other one is method of consistent deformation. They are both force method of analysis. That means you find the force first, then you find the displacement, which is different from slope deflection method. You find the slope first or the theta first, then you find the end moment, then you find the rest of the bending moment. Now we look at specific how actually we solve this using method of least work. And you find that it is quite similar when you use Castigliano's second theorem to solve the problem finding deflections. So there are similar steps when we solve for deflection using Castigliano's second theorem and we solve statically indeterminate structures using method of least work. Now I use this example, which is, this is a continuous beam. This is a continuous beam, a very simple two-span. This is a two-span, span AB and span BC continuous beam. And you have a load W here uniformly distributed. This is pin, roller, and roller, so immediately you see that this is statically indeterminate, and the degree of statical indeterminacy is equal to 1, which means we have one extra restraint, extra support. So this one can be taken away, This one can be taken away. And the structure is still able to take this load. So now we have to, in the steps, this is used to demonstrate to you the steps involved. The first thing that you do in method of least work is you, after you know what is the degree of statical indeterminacy, and degree of statical indeterminacy is equal to number of redundant forces. It is equal to one, so you have only one redundant force that you have to determine. So after that, you have to determine, you have to choose which one. Choose the one redundant force first. So here, in this example, we choose BY. BY is the reaction forces at support B here, the roller support here. The roller support here, this is a roller, this is a symbol for roller support, this is a pin support. So the first step is, after we know what is the degree of statical indeterminacy, then you choose the redundant force to be solved first. And we give, of course, in this case, we choose BY, and then we give it a name, B subscript Y. This is the normal symbol that we have been using at support point B in the Y directions. And what do you do next is you consider this as a kind of loading. You consider this as a kind of loading, which is actually redundant force, but you want to solve that. You don't know that magnitude yet, but you consider it as a loading. Together with this actual load given to us, uniformly distributed load W plus this BY. So we remove this roller support from this model here, and we apply the corresponding redundant force. Then you consider this as a kind of loading. It's a kind of loading, but remember it is not loading, but it is a redundant force that we want to solve. That's why we put an inverted comma here. Inverted comma here, so it is the loading now. This is the actual one plus the one that we want to solve, the redundant force. So they are considered as external load acting on this beam now. And under this loading and this loading, then the structures will deform. And when the structure deform, you have strain energy stored. So the strain energy now is a function of this loading plus the loading that we consider in this analysis where this loading comes from the redundant force. So the strain energy now is a function of this loading and this loading. Okay. According to Castigliano's second theorem, if you try to recall Castigliano's second theorem, if you del u, del by, differentiate this partially with respect to these unknown forces, by, acting at b in the y direction, this is equal to displacement. This is equal to displacement. B is here, so del strain energy, del partial differentiation of strain energy, respect to this force gives you the displacement at point b in y directions. So that is what we have learned in Castigliano's second theorem. Del u, del by will be equal to delta b. But because point b is support, meaning that in y direction it cannot move, so delta b must be equal to zero. So at the end, you get del u, del by equal to zero. So you get del u, del by equal to zero, and this is the extra equations, other than equilibrium equations that you need to solve statically indeterminate problem. And this is what we call compatibility equations. So from these equations, you solve for BY. You solve for BY. And this comes from Castigliano's second theorem. And because point B is a support point, deflection zero, so this is equal to zero. So this forms the compatibility equations. Then the other equations, once you solve this, don't forget equilibrium equation. This is the fundamental, you still need them anyway. After you solve for this, the rest of the equilibrium, the rest of the unknown forces, you can solve using equilibrium equations. Now, the meaning of this equation, we look a little bit on the meaning of this equation, del u, del by equal to zero. So if we plot a graph, strain energy versus by. This is what we have in this slides here. If we plot a graph, the vertical axis is strain energy, the horizontal axis is by. Then that equations u versus by, by changing by you get this curve. So the strain energy will change when you change the magnitude of by. And at a certain value, of by, then you get the strain energy minimum. And the slope to this point here, del u del by equal to zero. So del u del by is equal to the slope at this point where the u is minimum. And so that brings us to the principle of least work. This is the principle where the method of least work is based on. Method of least work based on this principle. The principle says that the magnitude of the redundance, remember the by just now, of a statically indeterminate structures, the magnitude of that redundant force that is acting on the statically indeterminate structures, the magnitude must be such that the strain energy stored in the structure is a minimum. And because strain energy is equal to internal work done, so internal work done is the least. So the magnitude of by, I show you three cases here. The magnitude of by, the correct answer of the redundant, when you substitute into strain energy, it must make the strain energy a minimum value. So this by prime is not the answer. By star is not the answer. And other by other than this one, which makes the strain energy a minimum value, the by here, by here, by there, by there, they are all not the answers. So the correct answer that we want to find is the one that makes the strain energy a minimum value. And because strain energy is equal to internal work done, so strain energy minimum means the internal work done is the least, is the smallest. So that's why we have the principle of least work. The magnitude of the redundance of the statically indeterminate structure must be such that the strain energy stored in the structure is a minimum, or in other words, the internal work done is the least. This is where the method of least work comes from. And it is represented using these equations here. Del u, del any of the redundant equal to zero. And this is a statement representing method of principle of least work. And this is the equation that we need to use in solving statically indeterminate structures using method of least work. So what do we do when there are cases where, this is a very beautiful example, we have many, many spans. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this is a continuous beam, a very highly statically indeterminate continuous beam. You have 1 span, 2 span, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 span. Continuous beam, and this is statically indeterminate, and the degree of statical indeterminacy will be more than one. So the same thing like when you solve for your slope deflection methods, when you have unknown theta, you can have unknown theta more than one. That is your statical indeterminacy. You can have unknown theta more than one. So in that case, you have to solve simultaneous equations. For the case of least work, method of least work, when you have I, this is degree of statical indeterminacy, I more than one, then you have to identify. If I is 4, then you have to choose 4 redundants. You have to identify 4 redundants. If I is 10, then 10. If I is 100, then you choose 100. If I is 2, then you have to choose 2 redundants. For example, if you have redundant, total number of redundants is equal to n. If the degree of statistical indeterminacy is equal to n, then total number of redundants will be equal to n. So you have R1, R2, R3. For example, you call them R1, R2, R3, R4, R5 until Rn. N can be 2, then you have R1 and R2. Then the strain energy will become a function of the actual load. And R1 and R2, R3, this is R1 and R2, R3, R4, R5, R6, R7 until Rn is applied as a loading. It's applied as a loading on the structures. And how do we evaluate them? Then you have to form this number of equations. Del U del R1 equal to 0, one equation. Del U del R2 equal to 0, another equation until del U del Rn equal to 0. So you have n equations. If the redundant is 2, then you have 2 equations. Then you solve this. You solve this simultaneously. So you have a simultaneous equations, 2 unknowns, 2 redundant forces, 2 equations. That comes from principle of least work. Then you solve for the redundant, then you get the redundant forces. Then you use the equilibrium equation, you solve for the rest. So that is how we extend when you have more than one redundancy. And it is very common for us to have structures, the redundancy is more than one. Okay, commonly the redundancy is high. Okay, but we'll look at example starting with redundancy equal to 1 first. But it can be extended to the case where redundancy is more than 1. So when redundancy is more than 1 is equal to 2, then you have 2 equations. Then you have to solve that 2 equations simultaneously. Okay, so that is the basic steps. First, you identify the degree of statistical indeterminacy. So remember how you identify degree of statistical indeterminacy. You have to choose. You have to see how many unknown forces you have. Then you have to see how many equilibrium equations you have. Okay, then unknown forces minus equilibrium equation that you have, that is degree of statistical indeterminacy. Then you choose the redundant. Then you apply the redundant on the structures. Then you apply principle of least work. You solve for the redundant. Then next you solve for the other unknown forces. Okay, so let's look at one example, which is a very simple one, where the degree of statistical indeterminacy is only equal to 1. So this is a very simple statistically indeterminate problems involving a beam. This is a continuous beam. It's not simply supported anymore. It is continuous beam, which means you have 2 span here, 1 pin, 1 roller, and 1 roller. Similar to example that I used for explanation just now, but now we have a loading 30 kN per meter. This is actual loading. And there's a point load here, 80 kN. So this can represent a part of a frame structures in the building. We have pin support, roller support here, and the actual loading. EI given to you is constant. EI is constant. So the question is, determine the reactions for the continuous beam shown above using method of least work. Okay. So now, try to recall back what we have looked at the previous slides. The first thing what we have to do, the next what we have to do, and after that, finally, we answer the questions, what are the reaction forces? What are the reaction forces? So, number of reaction forces, easy to count, 1, 2, 3, 4, you have 4. Number of reactions, you have 4 here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Number of equilibrium equation for this one, you have only 3. So degree of statistical indeterminacy is 1 here. So you have one redundant that you need to solve. Degree of statistical indeterminacy, one. So after that, you choose redundant. You choose the redundant. So we have the choice here. You have the choice here to choose. I can choose redundant at B here. I can choose redundant at D. I can also choose redundant at A. So either one of these can be used. And you need to choose only one, because the degree of statistical indeterminacy is one. So we choose BY. After that, you can try choosing B, C, Y, and C. Then you should get the same answer. So I choose BY. So BY is chosen as the redundant force, BY, and we apply it as a loading, as an external load. So you consider this BY as a forces, which is actually the reaction force, but in solving using method of least work, you apply it as a loading on the structure together with the actual loading. So you see here, I have BY prime. This is the reaction force DY. This is actually reaction, but with a double prime here, meaning that it is actually the redundant force that we want to solve. And this is the actual loading. 30 kN per meter, we know the value, and this is 80, we know the value. So the next thing that we have to do is we have to find the other unknown forces. We have to find the other unknown forces in terms of this redundant force and the other applied loading as well. So the next is you evaluate this AX, AY, DY. This is the other unknown reaction forces in terms of this loading that you apply plus this loading. So these are the series of, so you consider BY as a loading, then you have the actual loading, which is this and this. Then you evaluate the reaction forces, the other unknown reaction forces, by using the equilibrium equations. So equilibrium equation is needed. So you evaluate the other, so AX becomes zero, AY in terms of BY, AY plus DY, and then you find AY in terms of BY, and also finally DY in terms of BY. So you use equilibrium equations to find the other unknown reaction forces in terms of BY. So finally you get AY 245 minus 0.5 BY, DY 135 minus 0.5 BY. So they are in terms of this BY now. In terms of BY now. And BY is still unknown, and that is the value that we want to find. Okay? So after we find this, what do we want to do next? So these are the result of this calculation here. So reaction force in terms of BY, this reaction force that we want to find in terms of BY. And once we know BY, then we substitute here, we know AY, substitute here, we know DY. Okay. Now, according to principle of least work, we need to differentiate this strain energy. And the strain energy that is involved here, this is a beam problem. So the strain energy is equal to half bending moment square over EI. And we need to differentiate this partially with respect to BY and make it equal to zero. So we need to differentiate strain energy, and according to principle of least work, del U del BY is equal to zero. According to principle of least work, differentiate partially the strain energy stored in this beam here with respect to the redundant force must be equal to zero. This is from the principle of least work. So because U is this, so del U, del BY, if you recall what we have gone through in Castigliano's second theorem, so this becomes del M, del BY, M O E I D X, but this whole thing equal to zero. In Castigliano's second theorem, del u del by will be equal to deflection at point B in y directions. But in principle of least work, because this by is actually a redundant reaction force, and that point is deflection is zero, that's why it becomes zero here. So this is the one that you have to evaluate. And once you get this MACDIN equal to zero from that equation, you get by. You get by. And if EI is constant, then EI will not affect. If EI is constant for the whole beam, so EI does not affect your reaction forces. But if EI is not constant, then it will affect. So because if EI is constant, you take out EI, then and the EI disappears. You can factor out EI if EI is constant. So you see that EI does not affect the magnitude of the redundant force. But if EI is not constant, then it is another story. So when you come to here, then you immediately remember you have to make table. The most important thing is because you have to integrate this multiplied with this. So you have to find this bending moment and then differentiate that bending moment with respect to by and multiply them and then integrate and then finally make them all equal to zero. So bending moment has to be evaluated. So bending moment, try to recall how to evaluate bending moment for this beam. So you have to evaluate three times, one time here, once for here, another one time for there. And then we can use the x, the origin, it depends on us, so I choose this part. For part A to B, use origin at A. For part B to C, use origin at D. And for part C to D, use origin at D as well. So you evaluate the bending moment, and then you differentiate the bending moment with respect to the redundant force. So this is the result, the table. Okay? So you have the segment here. This you have to know how many times you have to evaluate depending on the loading and also depending whether EI is changing or not. So origin, this depends on where you choose the X from, and this is representing which part you want to evaluate the bending moment. And the limit will be affected by the origin. This shows where it is. 0 to 5 is for D to C with the origin at D. 5 to 10 is for C to B at the origin at D. This is not C to B, it's C to D. Not C to B, but it should be C to D. Okay. So for D to C at origin D and for C to B is correct. C to B at origin D. We refer to the figure up there. And don't make mistake here in the limit of integrations. Then bending moment evaluated. And then del M del BY. So this part is similar to Castigliano's second theorem. Castigliano's second theorem also you make this kind of table. Okay, del M del BY. Try to recall how to differentiate this partially. You differentiate partially with respect to by, okay? Not respect to x, not respect to y, not respect to any other thing, but you differentiate partially with respect to the redundant force. Remember that? So you differentiate this partially, you get negative 0.5x. You differentiate this, you still get negative 0.5x, and also, okay? Remember, you differentiate partially with respect to the redundant force. So after that, what you do is this one multiply with this, integrate from 0 to 10. This one multiply with this, which is substitute into this equation here, integrate from 0 to 5. This one multiply with this, integrate from 5 to 10. And then happy integration. So this part, sometimes it takes a lot of time. Because it is not difficult, but sometimes it becomes very long. Become one full page. So don't make mistake here. This is a simple integration, but sometimes it becomes very lengthy. And finally, you see EI. EI is constant for all. So EI can be factored out. So at the end, EI, because this is equal to zero, EI does not affect your BY if EI is constant. So finally, what we get is, we get these equations. So these equations, which is the compatibility equation, which comes from principle of least work, gives us BY. It gives us BY, and we get positive, meaning that the direction that you assume is correct. If you get negative, mean the direction that you assume is opposite, not correct. Then after that, you see these two equations, these are the equilibrium equations that we use to evaluate AY in terms of BY. Once you know BY, you substitute here, you get AY. Substitute here, you get DY. Okay? And with this BY, AY, DY, then you solve the problem. You solve the problem. So once you have BY, which is solved using this method of using these least work equations, this is redundant that we have chosen. Once you calculate this, substitute back to the equilibrium equations, then you can get AY, you can get DY. AX is equal to zero. Okay, so that is actually the steps that we need to go through when we solve statically indeterminate beam problem using method of least work. Determine statical indeterminacy, choose redundant, and then calculate the rest of the unknown forces in terms of the redundant. Then you have to apply principle of least work. So we go through this. Identify degree of statical indeterminacy. Then you choose one as the redundant. Here we choose BY. Apply the loading BY as a kind of loading on the structures, and then calculate other unknown forces in terms of the redundant force. So you get this AY in terms of BY, DY in terms of BY. Then you have to, because of this principle of least work, this is according to principle of least work, del U, del BY, the redundant that you have chosen is equal to zero. This is actually equal to this, because U is equal to this equation here for beam. Then in order to evaluate this, to find BY, you have to find bending moment and differentiate bending moment respect to BY. And you bank table, this is to help us to get this and this to substitute here. Then finally, you make them equal to zero. Do not forget EI. Then finally, you get these equations, which comes from the compatibility equations you solve for BY. Then you get the other reaction forces, AY and DY. So that helps us, that is the whole solution process if we want to find the reaction forces. So after we find reaction forces, what do you do? Why do we need to find reaction forces? After we find reaction forces, what do we do? Why do we need to find reaction forces? After we find reaction forces, what do we do next? We apply. Okay, apply it for what? Principle of analysis. Okay.
To find deflection.
Yes, you can find deflections. Also, you can find bending moment, you can draw bending moment diagram, then you can draw the shear force diagram. Because if you want to draw bending moment shear force diagram, if you don't know all the reaction forces, you cannot draw the bending moment and shear force diagram. And also to find deflections. But to find deflections, you have to go through the whole method of least work again, because when you apply one loading, if you want to find deflections, then you have to find the reaction forces again. So you use method of least work to help you to find the reaction forces. So remember, the main aim that we have solved here is to find reaction forces. But why we find reaction forces is for us to find bending moment diagram and shear force diagram. Because in order to draw that, you need to know all the reaction forces. So that is the basic of method of least work. And this is a beam problem. What happens when it goes to the truss problem? So before that, there is a, you ask to repeat the previous example using the following X coordinate system. So this is for you to actually go through the steps. It's actually the same example, but using other X coordinate system. So your bending moment equation will be a bit different, but the answer will be the same. So this is just to help you to go through that whole question again, but by using different coordinate system. You start the X, there's an X here, same here, but X start different from different origin. Then you get slightly different equation for bending moment. And you go through the whole process again, then you should get the same answer for AY, BY, and CY, and DY. Okay. Now there's other example here. There are four examples here, A, B, C, D. These are all statically indeterminate beams with degree of statical indeterminacy equal to 1. So find the reaction forces at support B. Find reaction forces for the beam shown below. Reaction forces here, what are the reaction forces here? So you have roller support, now you have a support here coming in, then you have this load linearly distributed, and you have the support coming into here. So these are all examples of statically indeterminate beam with degree of statical indeterminacy is equal to 1. And you can solve this easily by using method of least work. Okay. Now, we go through one example involving truss. We have seen beams. Now truss. This is a highly deformed truss. If this line are supposed to be straight line, okay? These are all members. These are straight members, not crooked members. These are all straight members. So this you have 1, 2, 3 member truss. Pin here, and there's a free joint here, and 90 kilonewton X there, the height 3.5, 4.5, 3.5. You are asked to trusses, normally truss, the problem that we want to solve in truss is to get all the, member forces. We want to find all member forces, because in truss, the important thing is to find member forces. In beam, the important thing is to find bending moment, and same thing for frame. Determine forces in all members of the truss shown. Use Castellano's second theorem together with method of least work. So this truss is a statically indeterminate truss. So you count how many members. Members M is equal to 1, 2, 3. M is equal to 3. How many joints do you have? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 joints. So 2 times 4 is 8. How many reaction forces do you have? How many reaction forces do you have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, reaction forces, R is equal to 6, M is equal to 3, 6 plus 3 is equal to 9. The joint, how many equilibrium equation do you have? Which is 2 times number of joint, 2 times 4 is 8. So 9 minus 8 is equal to 1. So remember, how do you evaluate the statical indeterminacy of truss? Compare M plus R with 2 multiplied with J. So degree of statical indeterminacy is equal to 1. So now we choose members. Here, the degree of statical indeterminacy, the redundancy is caused by extra members. The redundancy is caused by extra members. So we choose either one of these as the redundant members. Because this truss structure, to support this load, you need only 2 members. So the third one, either one of these, is actually extra members. So we choose member AD. You can choose, if you don't like AD, you can choose BD. If you don't like BD, you can choose CD. If you don't like AD, BD, and CD, you still have to choose either one of these. So here we choose AD as redundant members, and the forces in member AD as the redundant force. So force subscript AD as the redundant force. So this is a forces in member AD as a redundant force. Okay. Now, the same thing that we have done for beam, you apply these member forces as a kind of loading. Okay. You apply these member forces, you consider these member forces as a kind of loading acting on this truss together with these forces, together with this load which is given, 90 kilonewton. Then you use method of joint, you calculate the other member forces in terms of this FAD. So you consider this as a kind of loading, FAD, the member forces acting in the direction of the member. So we consider this as tension. We consider this force as tension force. Then together with this loading, then you find the other members, the forces in the other members. So here we use method of joint. So summation of forces acting at this joint in horizontal direction equal to zero. So you get, and also you get another equation, summation of forces at this joint in vertical direction, make it equal to zero. Then you get this equation 1 and 2. Then you solve them. You solve them simultaneously, then you get member forces in member DC. Forces in member DC is equal to these equations, which is in terms of FAD. So this is a redundant. And the same thing for forces in member DB. Then you get also in terms of the redundant member forces. So this is what we do with the thrust problem. Once you identify the redundant, you find the member forces in terms of that redundant, like what we have done here. So this FAD is a redundant force. FDC is a forces in member DC in terms of FAD. The same thing, FDB in terms of FAD. And now we come to applying the principle of least work. The strain energy stored in the thrust structures is equal to this, half summation member forces square multiplied with length divided by AE. Principle of least work, del U del FAD equal to zero. Then, because the strain energy is this, so we get this, del F AD, FLO AE, and this whole thing is equal to zero. So this is what you have seen in Castigliano's second theorem when you want to evaluate deflection in thrust structures. But here, this one, according to principle of least work, del F, the magnitude of this, must make the strain energy minimum. So del U del FAD equal to zero, and del U del FAD is equal to this, and this is equal to zero. So the next step is, as we have done in Castigliano's second theorem, you make table again. You make table, and this table, you have members here. You have the members. How many members do you have? The length you have to calculate, because you need this here. Forces. Forces in each of the member. So member AD, this is the redundant member that we have chosen, so the forces is FAD. BD is this, in terms of FAD, CD is in terms of FAD, and differentiate each of the member forces in terms of redundant, so you get 1 here, you get this negative 1.4030 for here, you get 1.1158. Okay, so differentiate each of the member forces in terms of, with respect to the redundant force. So this column here. So here is this one multiplied with this. Here, AE is not used here because AE is constant for all members. If AE is not constant, then you have to consider here in this column. So you have this one multiply with this, you get this, and so on, this multiply with this, and you get this column, and what do you do for this? You this plus this, you get this. And this is the equations that we need to make it equal to zero. To make it equal to zero. And because AE is constant, so we can take out AE. That's why AE is not, no need to be considered here. If AE is not constant for all the members, then you have to evaluate. You have to evaluate FL over AE here. If AE is different for this member, different for this member, and different for that member. In this case, AE is constant for all the members. So finally, from these equations, which is here, it comes from here. So make this equal to zero, you get FAD. You solve for FAD. And you get positive. And you get positive means your assumption of the member forces, which is tension, is correct. If you get negative, which means it should be compressions. We always assume tension first, and then if your assumption is wrong, then you get negative. You can always assume compression, of course, if you like. But remember, whatever you assume, if final answer you get negative, means your assumption is wrong. So we get here positive, which means our assumption that this is tension is correct. And after that, remember, substitute back to the equations. Once this is known, then you can find this, you can also find this. So we get this positive, so our positive means tension. We get negative, our negative means compressions. Means compressions. So this is how we apply to problem involving thrust. Okay, so this is the answer, if I summarize here. So this is tension, this is a redundant force that we chosen, we determine this, after that we find this and we find this. So with the force acting like this, this should be in tension and this should be in compression, and this one depends. So this one, because it is trying to go this way, so this one tends to become longer, so it becomes tension. So this will be push, become compressions. And this one, it depends on the problems. So this is the answer that we have obtained, member forces. So in thrusts, what we are interested to find is always the member forces. Once we know the member forces, if you want to do design, then you can know the cross sections, look at the member forces and the material that you want to use. Just now we have chosen this as a redundant force. As I mentioned, if you don't like this, you don't like AD, then you can choose FBD as the redundant force. Then you have to find the member forces of this and this in terms of FBD. Then, this is the equation that you need to use. Del F, del FBD, FLOAE equal to zero. If you don't like this as well, then you can choose FCD. Then, in this case, you have to find these member forces in terms of FCD. And this is the equation that you have to use when you want to solve for the redundant force FCD. When you want to solve redundant force FBD, this is the equation that you have to use. If you don't like AD, you don't like BD, you don't like CD, then what do you do? If you don't like all three, then please, you discuss with me. You don't like all these three, then what to do? You don't like everything, all the members, so... But still, you have to solve the problems. Thank you very much, so... So, that is what I want to discuss today on method of least work. We look at one beam problems, one thrust problems. So, the first thing that you have to do is, in all problems, whether beam, thrust, and later on we are going to look at frame, and later on we are going to look at combination of a cable and beam, is you have to identify redundancy first. How many what is the degree of statical indeterminacy. If it is equal to 1, if it is 2, 3 or 4, then you choose your redundant. Then you find the other unknown forces in terms of the redundant. Then after that, you have to write down the principle of least work equations, and it depends. If it is a beam thrust problem, it comes something like this. If it is a frame or beam, then you have bending moment. Del M, del redundant, M divided by EI, you have to do integrations. Then from these compatibility equations, you solve for the redundant. Then finally, use equilibrium to get the other forces. So those are the main steps involved. Okay? So when I meet you again on Wednesday, then we look at how we apply this method of least work to a problem like this, where you have one cable, one beam. This member and this member, they have different characteristics. This become longer or shorter only. This will bend. And also, this can also become longer and shorter. So how do we combine? How do we solve a structure where you have a combination of two different types of members? One each is only become longer and shorter, like cable. Beam, it can bend, and also it can become longer or shorter. How do we solve a problem like this? So this is to attract you to come to Wednesday lectures. Okay, if this is attractions. So that's all for today. You have class after this? Where is your class? Ah, here. Okay. So you don't have to go. So that's all for today, and I'll see you again on Wednesday.